Greetings, my fellow Elmontians, and welcome to the 2020 school year, where most of you guys are out in the land of remote learning. We're going to kick off this school year with what Earth Science is all about, the branches of it, what makes it up, different things we're going to be studying, all sorts of good stuff. Okay? Before we do, please, you get your contracts yesterday. Make sure they are signed and submitted into the GC. All right, literally fill them out with your stylus or your finger, whatever you prefer, and make sure you submit them into the GC. That counts as your first homework assignment. Okay? Okay. So anyway, let's jump into it. I want to start with a little eerie clip. Pay close attention to the images you're seeing. Because I'd like to discuss them when we're done here. And there it is, folks. Welcome to Earth Science. Do me a favor, jot down some of the images that stuck out in your head there that you want to either chat about or ask about. Because in the end here, I'd certainly like to discuss that with you. All right, so hit pause, take a minute, and just jot down a couple of notes to yourself. Okay, so moving right along here, there are four major branches of Earth science, right? When you guys took living environment, you know, that's predominantly biology. When you take chemistry, it's predominantly chemistry. Physics, same thing. But Earth science is kind of a conglomeration of many different sciences. And it's what makes it, what I think, one of the most exciting sciences of them all, because you can get a little piece of everything and kind of make sense of the world around you. Okay? We'll start out your four big branches. You can probably guess by the pictures, of course. Your four major branches. We'll start out with geology. Probably heard that before. Not to be confused with geography, right? Two different things. One's more, well, a little, I guess, you'd study more in social studies, a little more about the surface of the land and that. But geology digs deep in within the earth. All right, and we'll get further on that in a moment. Then, of course, oceanography, right? Most of the Earth is covered by water, right? The blue planet. Ironically, however, you know, that whole question, you know, is water blue or what's going on there? Is the sky blue? And if you think about it, at nighttime, what color is the ocean? Have you ever been down to the beach at night, right? It's black. Well, the sky is black at night. And then you say, all right, well, you've been to the ocean during the day. What color is the ocean during the day? Well, it's blue. Well, the sky is blue during the day. So the ocean takes on the color of the sky, if you will. It reflects the color of the sky. And during the day, of course, we'll talk about refraction and scattering of light. But the blue wavelength is scattered throughout the sky during the day. And that blueness reflects off the ocean. Well, at night, there is no light entering the atmosphere, no light to be scattered, so you get black, and the ocean appears black. Okay? But anyway, the study of the oceans, oceanography, tides, tsunamis, right? All sorts of exciting stuff. It has a major impact on our climate, and we'll talk all about that. Meteorology, everybody sees a meteor there, and they think space. No, meteorology is the science of weather, and we'll, of course, focus on that in a moment. And that's where your tornado is there. And, of course, most people's favorite astronomy, not to be confused with astrology. Of course, astrology is, you know, they gazed in the heavens back in the day, and they came up with different ideas on what would affect people's personalities, born under the influence of, and we'll talk all about that. But astronomy is the actual science of what's going on. And, you talk about from the moons to the planets to the stars, the galaxies, and beyond. Truly fascinating topic. Okay? So how do we define geology, right? The Earth, digging into the Earth. We'll take a look here. You got a lot of fossils. Here you have some exposed rock strata, of course, volcanism. A little simulation there with Pangaea, right? Continental drift. We'll get into that. But jot it down, geology, the study of Earth's history, structure, processes, and composition of its surface and interior. That's a mouthful right there. But yeah, everything basically going on beneath your feet that you don't see directly, but we certainly experience the results of. Okay, a little more beautiful geology in action, right? These are sedimentary layers, beautifully horizontal layers compacted over time. Here you have also sedimentary formations, but a lot of weathering and erosion has broken it away, and it's sculpted the landscape into this beautiful area. All right, same thing over here, right? You've all heard of the Grand Canyon. Well, that's a great little panorama of the Grand Canyon, a river dug down about over a mile at this point, and it's still digging because water has this abrasive property to it, and it literally cuts through the rock like a knife over millions and millions of years. And if you ever do hike the Grand Canyon someday, the deeper you go, guess what happens to the age of a rock? It gets older. So yeah, as you hike down the canyon, it's like taking a trip back in time. All right. But anyway, geology, truly a fascinating branch of Earth science. So moving on, again, more geological features. Okay, mountain regions. Earth's interior, all geology related, right? The inner layers of the Earth. You have your inner core, outer core, mantle, and the crust. And we haven't drilled down deep at all, right? Every time we try to drill down, it just melts, no matter what material we've tried to use on the drill bit. Okay, that's showing you a little plate tectonics with Pangaea, how the continents used to be in different places, all under the topic of geology. Truly amazing. Okay. Then we get into oceanography. You can certainly, from the pictures, you think a lot of biology, but there's a lot of physical processes going on as well, not just, the living things, but also the non-living, the inorganic things. And it has an enormous impact on the life in the ocean, but also the life on land. Okay? The defined oceanography, the study of the Earth's oceans, currents, tides, waves, of course, the term tsunami we threw out before, that's not to be confused with regular tides, right? A tsunami, we call it a tidal wave. It has nothing to do with the tides. The tides are controlled mostly by the gravity of the moon, right? But also the sun's gravity as well. And that's a cyclic phenomenon, right? You get two highs a day, two lows a day. But tidal wave is different. Tidal wave is caused by a shifting of the Earth's crust, right? A geologic process. And when that happens from an earthquake, it generates an enormous wave, and we call that a tidal wave or a tsunami. Okay? So truly amazing. Beautiful coral formations. Everybody thinks they're plants. They're actually a very, very simple type of animal. Beautiful colors. Of course, you've heard of bleaching of the corals, right? As we pollute the oceans, corals have a hard time adapting to that, and they start to die out. Ocean currents are a major, major player on not only weather, but climate, long-term climate. And if you look, you get this warm water that leaves the equator, and that makes everything warmer up here. And one of the theories as to how you might go into an ice age is, well, what if these currents changed, right? What if the warm water wasn't coming up anymore? It would get a lot cooler. And that's the idea of how an ice age would begin, because you're no longer distributing heat away from the equator efficiently. All right, so oceanography is truly amazing. Then there's meteorology. Again, this is not meteors thinking like weather. Thinking space. This is more weather related, okay? And of course, the classic lightning storm. These are layers of the atmosphere here, and all of our weather occurs in the troposphere. We'll talk about that in a minute. But get your definition down, right? The study of Earth's atmosphere, weather, and of course, long-term weather we call climate. Okay? Okay. Now, lightning is truly amazing. You might have heard the expression, it never strikes the same place twice. Well, that's not necessarily true. Certainly, it's very random, and it could strike the same place twice. You got to think of it like a battery, right? You have positive charge on one side, negative on the other, and when those two come together, you get that zap, that flow of electricity. And it's truly amazing, and people have studied lightning for a long time. You probably heard the story of Ben Franklin with the kite and the key. The amount of electricity is truly amazing. They say something like 60,000 volts. The temperature is off the charts. And people that do get hit by lightning, you know, obviously have a good chance of dying, but some survive. And the stories they tell is truly amazing. They get totally blacked out. They get severely burned. But most of the lightning never went through their bodies. If it did, they would have died. Only like a small part goes through and then an exit to the ground. Okay. Anyway, troposphere, that's where we live, that's where all our weather is. When you're in an airplane, you're above the most of the weather, you're above the clouds, you're way in the upper troposphere. And that's because it's safer to fly where there's less weather phenomena. All right, and this heads up on here where the blue meets the black, right? The rim of outer space. All right, hurricanes, of course, we're coming into hurricane season, as you know, or maybe you don't know, but hurricane season starts, in the summer, and then it works its way into the fall. June, I believe, is the official start of the season, but as the oceans get warmer in later summer, like July, August, and then, of course, September toward the end, the hurricanes get bigger. As our climate warms, hurricane season has stretched later, October and possibly even November, but after that, the ocean gets too cold, and you can't generate a big storm like that in cold water. That's the classic hurricane path right there, right, going up the East Coast. So over the next month or two, we'll be tuning into hurricane watches because they start way out here in the Atlantic and the planetary winds push them toward us and then they hook and could possibly come toward Elmont. All right. And that's satellite imagery of a hurricane. They'll move counterclockwise in our hemisphere. They spin the other way when you go below the equator. Tornado is a similar but very different storm, right? Hurricanes last a long time, tornadoes a short time. Hurricane covers an enormous area, tornadoes much, much smaller of an area. However, the wind speed can be much greater in a tornado, which is why whatever a tornado hits is absolutely destroyed. Whereas if you only got like a Category 1 hurricane, you'll have some severe damage, but not that direct impact like a tornado. Hurricanes have to start over water. Tornadoes can start over land or water. So they're very different, even though they have similarities as well. Okay, then of course we jump into astronomy. Everybody loves astronomy, right? Showing you here a nebula there, a stellar nursery where stars are born. Obviously this is an artist concept of things coming together in space. That's called accretion. And the force of gravity pulls things together, and that's how the eventually planets form, and even bigger than that, more mass, more gravity, eventually a star will be formed, all under this pull of gravity, right? The universal law of gravity, where matter is attracted to matter, and all things that have mass have a gravitational force, right? Matter has mass. So get your definition down there, the study of the universe, all matter, time, energy, and space. Okay? Another beautiful pictures. Okay, that's a picture of a galaxy. The Milky Way, the galaxy we live in, is this spiral galaxy. And from a top view, which in space there really is no top, but when you're looking down at a galaxy, this would be a spiral galaxy. And we're about two-thirds of the way out from the center on one of what they call the galactic arms. So our little solar system squeezes in here. One of those specks of light would be the sun, and all of the planets revolve around the sun. One of those little specks of light. They say our galaxy is over 100,000 light years across, which is truly staggering, being that our sun, which is insanely far away, right, 90-something million miles away, the light takes about 6.5 minutes to get here. But going across our galaxy, it would take over 100,000 years. So size in space is truly mind-blowing. This is not drawn to scale, but of course it is showing you order out from the sun. You remember my very eager mother just served us nachos. Well, there you have it. let's see here. Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, etc. on out. And of course Pluto, right, it got the boot. Didn't really fit the pattern of the solar system. It got kicked out a few years back. But we'll still talk about it, right? That Pluto is one of everybody's favorites. Okay, also the phases of the moon, right? The moon has an enormous impact on life on Earth, and knowing how its phases affect, are related to the tides and how it affects us, really a neat topic. I know you'll enjoy that one. Okay, star trails, that's amazing, right? This is a time-lapse photo, and if you can hold the camera open while the Earth is rotating, you get these star trails, these arc lights across the sky. And these are tents here. People will head up toward the North Pole or in different parts of the world to see these star trails. You got to go to a dark place, of course. The Aurora Borealis, that's another fantastic one. As you head further north, it's easier to see. But it has been spotted from northern Long Island at certain times of the year. All right. This is all the interaction of sunlight in our atmosphere. And you get these charged particles that give off colors. Okay. All astronomy, folks, truly amazing. And we're going to cover all those topics and then some, so buckle up. A couple of summary questions for you. How do we define Earth science? Well, to keep it real general, it's the study of Earth history, its branches, which we just talked about, and of course, our place in the universe. Okay, what are the four branches? Do you remember them? I hope so. And if not, you can certainly go back, but here, you know, don't forget you had the astronomy and all that other stuff. And, of course, describe what you learned about each branch, and we'll talk about this in just a minute. Okay? If you got to pause and go back and look at something, go ahead. I'll meet you back in the GC.